Well, good morning. How are you, Harvest? Good. I did have coffee this morning because that's kind of how I roll, but that's good. You know, I love the times of greeting. This isn't just something that we do so that we can move the pulpit in the middle. You know that, right? It's actually like important. I mean, some people hate that time, but we're not just a bunch of people who all love Jesus and we happen to be in the same room together. We're a family. We're a part of the body of Christ, and that's why we do things like that, because we love each other, and we want a tangible way to express that. And, you know, sometimes we'll, if you don't fill out the register for a couple weeks, we'll send you a text or maybe an email, a letter, something like that, because we really do care about you. And please don't see this as like us trying to hound you about things, but it's really like, because we're a family, when a member of your family is absent, it's just like not the same. And so we really do care about you. We're really glad when you're here. And when you're not here, you're missed. We're missed together as a family. That's why we do some of those things. I'm grateful for our students who just got back from Wake Up. Yeah. We have been praying a ton for them. That's what these bracelets, many of us have been praying for specific students who've been gone on this trip, that God would move. And so we're excited to, they're probably all going to take a nap later today because they haven't really slept a lot, but trusting that the Lord moved in an incredible time. And one of my sons was a part of this time away, and I'm really glad for him to be there. But both of my boys, they share a room together at home because, you know, we live in the city, so you got to cram them all in one place. And so they share a room, and it's really hard for the younger brother when the older brother is away. You know, that like nighttime rituals, like, oh, he's not here. It's just that he misses his brother because he's not there. Because when he's away, there's something missing. It's just not the same. There's power in that presence together. It's the comfort of a friend who meets you for coffee during a difficult time in your life. It just takes the time to listen and to be there with you. It's the peace that comes from when a spouse returns from a long trip away out of town and they're finally back at home. There's power in the presence. We'll see today, there's power in the presence of a Savior who has all authority in our life. Jesus would say, it is I. I'm there. I'm with you. And there's power in his presence. So turn over in the book of Mark to Mark 6. We're going to start in verse 45. We are continuing, and actually today is the finishing of our series called All Authority, where we're looking at the authority that Jesus has over nature, the authority that Jesus has over demons, over sickness, over the natural world, that Jesus has all authority. And today we're going to see that there's power in his presence. But before we do, let's pray. Father, we are grateful, so grateful to be in this body of believers together, that you've called us out of isolation and into a family. God, we thank you for ultimately your presence in our life, that you are near to us. You're near to us when things are going well. You're near to us when things are difficult, because you are a loving and faithful God. We thank you that you have all power, all authority in our lives, that we can trust you. We pray, Lord, as we look at this text today, we pray that your Spirit would be moving and illuminating the pages of your word to us, that we would take these things to heart, that you would change us because of your word and because of your Spirit working in us through your people together today. It's all for your glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so let's begin reading Mark 6, 45 through the end of the chapter. Immediately, he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had taken leave of them, he went up on the mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and he was alone on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. He meant to pass by them, but when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost and cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." And he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased. And they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. When they had crossed over, they came to the land at Gennesaret and moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countryside, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and implored him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well. We see here one of Mark's favorite words, immediately, right afterwards. Now, right after all that had happened last week, do you remember what happened last week? Jesus feeds the 5,000. It's this incredible miracle with these thousands of people around. And Jesus takes a small boy's lunch and turns it into food for thousands and thousands of people. And right after that happens, immediately after that happens, he what? He made his disciples get into the boat before him to go to the other side. Now, this is a little strange to me because this incredible miracle happens. Remember, the disciples were even part of it. Like Jesus is breaking these little loaves of bread and giving it to the disciples, and they're getting to serve all of the people. And then afterwards, they get to collect all the leftovers and put them in the little doggy bags and things like that. 12 large baskets full of bread and fish that was left over. They get to play a part in this incredible miracle. And then Jesus is like, all right, beat it. That's my translation. Jesus makes them go away. There's no debrief session. I would think that they would be pretty reluctant. This is their rabbi, their master, and they've just seen this incredible miracle. I can see them being like, wait. We got to talk about what just happened. How did you do that? What was happening? Where did you get all that stuff? There was 5 little loaves, but there's no debrief session. There's no training. There's no, this is how I did it, guys. There's no inside track. There's just get in the boat, go to the other side. See you later. That's what happens. And it's an incredible thing that he sends them away. They go from a spiritual and experiential high to a deep, dark low. Very, very quickly. But we'll see that Jesus will call to them. He will say, it is I. He will say, I am sovereign over your storm. I'm sovereign over your storm. He sends them, it says, towards Bethsaida, which is mostly north of where they were along the shore of the Sea of Galilee. We'll see later in the text that they don't end up there because of the severe wind that's in their face. But Jesus sends them along while he takes the time to dismiss the crowds. What compassion Jesus shows here. So if you think back several verses in this, first what happens is, on a very happy note, Jesus finds out that his cousin, John the Baptist, was murdered. And then right after that, thousands and thousands of people flock to him right after he hears about it. And he teaches all of them, all this while he's hurting. Think of the grief that he would have because his friend, his fellow ministry partner, his cousin was murdered. But he's ministering to people, teaching them. And then they're all starving and he feeds these thousands of people. Now, I would be like, I need a nap. I need a vacation. It's just too much. There's only so much I can handle. But then Jesus, he even gives his disciples a little bit of a break, and he takes the time with compassion to send the people away, to say bye to them as they're leaving. It's an incredible compassion that he shows here. Jesus sends these people away, and then he must go take a nap, right? He's got to take a vacation after that. But that's not what we see in the text. What does he do? In verse 46, he went up on the mountain to pray. Now, it's nighttime at this point, and Jesus is like, I'm going on the mountain to pray, to be alone with the Lord, and to seek his face. Now, Mark is a book of Acts. action. And so in it, we don't see a ton of times when Jesus is retreating like this, like we do in some of the other Gospels. We see it over and over in Matthew and in John and in Luke, but Mark focuses on the action that Jesus is taking and his exterior ministry and all of those kinds of things. This is one of only three times in the book of Mark that we see Jesus retreating by night to go pray. But make no mistake, Jesus did this very often in his ministry. Many of us desire to be used by the Lord in incredible ways, but we're unwilling to actually take the time to pray. We're unwilling to take this retreat from action to seek the Father's face, to ask for the Spirit to move through us. Jesus did this. Maybe you covet the public impact of others, but you're unwilling to replicate their private devotion. Listen, the roots of prayer go deep before the fruit is ever seen in ministry. And Jesus is making the roots go deep in his relationship with the Father. And he's modeling to us that before we are impacting the world for Jesus Christ, that first we're seeking the face of the Father, that our relationship with Jesus Christ is the most important. Men, get to the prayer breakfast on Sunday. I don't know a way I can say that stronger. If God is going to move in our campus, in our church, in our city for Jesus Christ, it starts with prayer. It's going to start with us falling on our knees and coming before the Lord. That is the hard work of ministry. It's not based on our successes. It's not based on our talents or our abilities or how many people we have serving or any of those things. It's based on God's favor and his Spirit moving in this city. That's what would change the world for Jesus Christ. Now, I want to let you in on a little inside thing. I was pushing for it in a meeting this week. I don't know if it'll happen. We'll see. I haven't talked with our elders just yet about it. I want to change the order of our pillars. Now, I'm all in favor for all of those things. I'm committed to God's word more than ever. I'm committed to passionately worshiping Jesus Christ in spirit and truth. Believe me, I want to share the good news of Jesus Christ with boldness to all who will listen. And I'm committed to unconditional love. But if we don't seek the Lord in prayer, none of that matters. If he doesn't fill our sails with wind, the boat's not going anywhere. And so we're seeking the Lord in prayer. It isn't to be a last resort. It should be our first habit that immediately we're coming before the Lord. That you see Jesus here, he just gets a moment alone and he's like, I'm going to pray. I need to do that. And we need to be called to do that as well. But what's so interesting here is that he's up on the mountain. Can you picture it? So there's the Sea of Galilee below, and he's up on this mountain, and he's able, the text tells us that from where he's praying, he sees them. He's able to physically see the disciples down in the boat. They likely would be able to see them. It's dark, remember, there's no electricity back then. But they would have had some torches on the boat or something like that. So you can picture it. Jesus is up on the mountain praying, and he's looking down the mountain to this sea, and he sees this tiny little boat, maybe three or four little torches, just kind of zigzagging back and forth. And he can tell they're not making much progress here. He's able to see them, and the text says that he's able to see that they're making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. It means there's lots of effort. There's a guy on our staff who's done a lot of sailing before, and we talked to him this week about, like, what is that like when there's tons and tons of wind? And he said, especially, you know, there's no motor or anything like that. But he said what they would do is they would sort of zigzag in the wind to try to cut across it. But apparently, they're continuing to do that, and they're not making much headway at all. Rather than moving in a straight line, they're just zigzagging and barely moving along at all. Now, remember, several of these guys were professional fishermen, and this was their home sea. Like, they were very familiar with this place. It's probably one of their boats. These guys knew what they were doing, and they're not making any progress at all, struggling and struggling, but not seeing any results. Now, this isn't like what we saw in chapter 4 where Jesus calms the storm. Remember that, where he stands and he says, peace, be still, and the wind and the waves just stop? It's not quite like that, because we don't see that there's anything in the text that shows that they're fearful of their lives. remember in chapter 4, they thought they were going to die. Don't you care that we're perishing? They don't feel that. This is just a struggle. It's painful. They're not going to die, but they're not going to make any progress either. See, there's times when you feel like the storm is just too much for you. I just can't take it. It's too heavy. I need Jesus immediately. And there are times like this when you feel like the storm is just too long. It just continues to go. Everyone can handle a bad wave or two. Everyone can have a short season where, man, that was a really rough week. But the real difficulty in life comes when the wind and the waves just won't let up. When is this going to be over? When am I going to be on the other side of this trial? When is this wind going to stop and I can sail smoothly again? Here's a few things. I feel the wind when. When am I prone to really feel this wind that's in my face? Not just a bad wave or two, but an ongoing season. First, it takes more effort to go the same distance. The disciples here are traveling the same distance that they have traveled probably thousands of times, but they're not making progress. I used to be able to go about my life just fine. I used to be able to get the kids to school, and I used to be able to get to work, and I used to be able to get home and have dinner and then have time before a small group. But then I hit this trial, and everything is hard. It takes more effort to do every little thing in my life. I'm just dealing with this trial over and over. I feel the wind when it takes more effort to go the same distance. I feel the wind when all I see is the damage that it's doing. You know, those of us who have followed the Lord, we recognize that God allows trials in our lives so that we will grow. It's what's best for us, even though it doesn't feel good at the time. Hebrews tells us that all discipline is beneficial when we're trained by it. And so sometimes you're in a trial and you're like, I can see that I'm growing through this. The Lord's teaching me patience. The Lord's teaching me humility through this. The Lord's teaching me to whatever it is. And so when those things are happening, you're able to be in the storm a little easier. But when all I see is the damage it's doing, all I see is the pain that it's causing, I'm not seeing any rewards. I'm just seeing the hurt. I believe that God works all things for the good of those who love him, but all I see is pain. I'm not seeing any of that good right now. And then third, I feel the wind when I can't go back inside. I can't get out of this wind. I'm not able to escape what's happening. There isn't an out for me. I'm not able to see a way out, and I don't see the end coming anytime soon. This is those times that you go to the Lord in prayer and you're like, Lord, I'm just praying that you make a way where there isn't a way because I don't see a way. Please help me. You just these simple prayers of faith because I can't escape what's happening here. But notice in this text, the disciples weren't struggling because they were deviating from what Jesus had told them. Well, there's plenty of times in God's word, and especially in the book of Mark, that the disciples are in trouble because they're not following what Jesus told them to do. They're not struggling here painfully against the wind because they're somewhere that Jesus didn't intend. They're struggling because they're exactly where Jesus told them to be. That Jesus superintended this trial for them. Now, we don't know why, but they're struggling because they're doing what Jesus asked. Whenever Jesus is apart from the disciples, they find themselves in distress. Many times it's because they're not doing what Jesus told them to do. But every time we see it in the book of Mark, they're failing. And they're failing because they fail in faith. How often is this true of us? That we go through a difficult season and we fail in it. We struggle more in it because we're unable to trust the Lord through it. But Jesus makes them go. He's watching them from the mountain. I don't think they knew that he was watching. But Jesus, can you see him? He's up there on the mountain, on his knees, praying. I wonder what he's praying for. Maybe he's praying for his disciples. Maybe he's praying for strength to continue to minister to people. We don't really know, but Jesus is up there. He sends them away into this wind. And then he's sitting there watching them as they're struggling. Make no mistake, Jesus understands. Jesus knows what you are going through, and he's watching the whole time. He's in control of all of this. He has placed you in that job. He's watching you as you make those difficult decisions that are God-honoring, that others around you may not make those same decisions. It might be a little easier for them. He's watching you in that job as your boss doesn't support you, as those people around you would malign you. He sees all of that. He placed you in that job. He placed you in that family. He's watching as you walk through broken relationships. He's watching as you walk through heartache, waiting for a change that you feel like might not ever come. He's watching. He puts you there. He's given you that body. He's watching as you walk out of another doctor's appointment this week, still unsure of what is going on and how to fix it. He's given that to you. He's watching, and he's in control. You can trust his authority. Even when I can't see anything but the trial, I'm able to trust him. Jesus' followers are never expected to be fearless in every circumstance. But we are expected to learn from what God has done in the past, from his faithfulness to us, and to grow in our faith for the future, that we would trust him more next week because of the wind that's in front of me today. And here comes Jesus walking on the sea. She's crazy. Did you hear the one about Jesus and Moses golfing? I love cheesy stories like this. So Jesus and Moses are out golfing at TPC Sawgrass. It's that famous 17th hole, has the island green with water all around. It's very, very small, very hard to hit. So Jesus and Moses are there, and they're golfing, and Jesus walks up, and he says, "Now watch, I was watching Tiger Woods last week on TV, and he put this 2 feet from the pin. He puts this, it's right in the water." No, Moses, I'm telling you. Tiger did this. Watch. Just like Tiger. Another one in the water. Man, yeah. And Moses is like, come on, let's just pick it up. No. Tiger did this. I could do this. It's just one more. In the water again. Now Jesus is out of golf balls at this point. So Jesus goes walking onto the water, out to get his golf balls, and he's picking up all his golf balls that went in the water. Moses is standing on the tee waiting for him. And the group behind him comes up and looks at Moses, and they're like, "Who's this guy think he is, Jesus?" And Moses says, "No, I think he's Tiger Woods." But Jesus didn't do this just for fun. He didn't do this to retrieve a couple golf balls. He did this to make a very specific point that he's in control. And notice, he comes about the fourth watch of the night. This is about between 3 and 6 a.m. So get this, long, long day of ministry, right after he found out that his cousin had been murdered. He's caring for all these people. The disciples get in a boat sometime around evening. They've been in the water for like 7 to 9 hours at this point. Like, they're not trying to go far. The whole lake is like 7.5-8 miles across if you go like the long way. So like, they're only a couple miles out of there, and they've been at it for 7 to 8 hours, barely making any headway. Remember, no motor or anything like that. But it's interesting that Jesus came to them that late. He didn't come to them in the first hour or the first watch of the night where they'd be tempted to say, "Man, Jesus, I'm really glad that you were here. That wind, it's tough. But I mean, we could have gotten through it, but you sure made it easier for us." No, he came when their sail of self-sufficiency lies shredded and soaked at the bottom of the boat. And that's when Jesus comes to us, when there are no other options but to trust Jesus. And sometimes he needs to put you at the end of yourself, where your sail of self-sufficiency is shredded and soaked, and you'll finally look to him. But notice also, he didn't come too late. He didn't come when they were beyond despair. Make no mistake, Jesus is in total control of your storm, and he shows up at the perfect time. Now, I love this little sentence in the end of 48. Did anyone else laugh when you first read this? It says, "He meant to pass them by." What in the world? What is that there for? But every time something is in God's word, you can make no mistake, it's there for a reason. So we're supposed to know this, that he meant to pass them by. I mean, was he trying to be sneaky? Like, could you see Jesus like tiptoeing on the water? Like, don't want to splash too much so they don't see me. No, because where he was on the mountains, trust me, it would have been quicker for him to go around and just walk on the land. And it's pretty dark. So if he wanted to really pass by them and them not see it, he would just walk far enough away. They wouldn't see him at all. But he doesn't do that. So why does he mean to pass by them? Well, Exodus 33 tells the story of when God takes Moses and puts him in the cleft of a rock and covers him with his hand. And the text says that God passes by Moses, that he allows Moses to see a glimpse of his glory, just sort of like the swoosh behind God as God passes him by. And in 1 Kings 19:11 tells us the story of Elijah, where Elijah wants to see the Lord. And we hear about the strong wind and the earthquake and the fire, and the Lord wasn't in any of those. And it says that God passes by, that he was in the low whisper or the still small voice. God was showing Elijah a glimpse of his glory through that. And then Job 9:8-11 says, God, who alone stretched out the heavens and trampled the waves of the sea, who made the bear and Orion and Pleiades in the chambers of the south, who does great things beyond searching out and marvelous things beyond number. Behold, he passes by me and I see him not. He moves on, but I do not perceive him. Since God only tramples on the waves, Jesus is demonstrating his divine authority. While the disciples didn't get it at that point, Mark's readers would be able to understand that this passing by was pointing back to the times that God specifically revealed his glory to people. That's what Jesus is doing here. He's giving the disciples, he's giving the readers of Mark, and he's giving us a glimpse of his glory. But you see, they don't get it at all. They think he's a ghost. I mean, I get it. Like, it's dark. There aren't any lights except for like the few torches. But it's a little strange to me that of all that they've seen Jesus do, the incredible miracles that they've seen Jesus do, that their first thought isn't, hey, maybe, is that Jesus out there? Their first thought is, it's a ghost. But that's where they come from. It's a ghost. All of the disciples have seen these things, but they put constraints in their minds on what Jesus can and cannot do. Sometimes you can't see Jesus in the middle of your storm because you've put him in your little safe flannel graph Jesus box, and you're unable to see the fullness of Jesus's authority. You have a limited understanding of Jesus's complete authority. You will miss him in the midst of your storm. If you're thinking, Jesus wants me to be happy. Jesus wants to bless me. Jesus would never put me through anything difficult. That's not what God's word has to say. But here's the truth. Nothing happens outside his control. Nothing is outside of his perfect plan. He made the disciples go. He's watching them all along. And then he's there with them. He's not just aware of the waves. He's treading on them. This is no big deal to our king. For a rabbi who saw the primary action of his ministry as preaching, though, he says only 9 words in this entire account. But they're powerful and comforting words. He says, take heart. It is I. Don't be afraid. And their terror turns to amazement. But notice, he didn't offer them a fix. He didn't walk up and be like, hey guys, you wanna grab a paddle? Hey, let me tell you about this boat that they're gonna invent in thousands of years that will actually help you cut through the wind a lot more. It'll make all of this a lot easier. He doesn't do any of those things. He offers simply his presence. It is I. It's me. I'm here. Jesus doesn't give practical provision. He gives his powerful presence. The same God who speaks in Deuteronomy 31 and Joshua 1 and 1 Kings 8 and 1 Chronicles 28, I will never leave you or forsake you, simply says here, it's me. I'm here. And maybe that's all you need from Jesus today. Maybe that's all you need from church today is to hear Jesus say, I'm with you. I'm here in the midst of that wind. I'm present and I'm in control. That's what Jesus says to them. Someday the winds will cease, but until they do, I want to remember that Jesus Christ is sovereign over my storm. I want to learn what he's teaching me through the storms of my life and to trust him through it. I want to glean everything that I can as I make painful headway, because I don't want to be in the same storm again. I want to learn the truth that Jesus has for me and to come through it. Jesus would speak over the storm happening in your life and in mine. I am with you and I am sovereign over your storm. And then he would speak, I am clarity in your confusion. I am clarity in your confusion. Jesus gets into the boat with them here in 51 and following. And as soon as he gets in, the wind stops. They're, of course, utterly astounded, like sort of beside themselves with all that's going on. But it's very interesting because the text doesn't say they didn't understand the wind. It actually says they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. It's crazy because it's very possible, as the disciples are in the boat here, that the 12 baskets of bread from the miracle the night before are in the boat with them. It's probably why they took the boat, because they got to take all these loaves now. We got these 12 baskets. So you can see them there struggling with the sail and paddles and things like that, and reaching over to nourish themselves with a piece of miracle bread. They're sitting there in the boat with a very tangible reminder of what Jesus Christ has just done, and they miss it. The disciples' problem wasn't that they weren't able to make headway against the wind. It wasn't the wind that was an issue. The problem here was that they hadn't learned from what they had seen. I think that prompts us to ask the question, what was the insight that they were supposed to learn from the feeding of the 5,000? Because here they're out in the wind, and he gave some bread. How does that actually connect? Well, in the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus' incredible compassion for those who have come to him and his divine power come together. And those two things together accomplish his purposes. They should have known that as Jesus would have compassion on them and power over any circumstance that they could possibly encounter. Now, Mark could have said they didn't understand about the casting out of demons or the cleansing of lepers or the healing of a paralytic or the man with a withered hand or the many people that came to him or the raising of Jairus' daughter from the dead. He could have listed all those things, but he just pointed back to the last thing. He just points back to the feeding of the 5,000. They didn't understand Jesus' power at work, and they missed it completely. It was right before their eyes. Again, it doesn't say that they didn't understand the storm. You don't have to understand the trial. You have to understand the one who's in control of the trial. You don't have to understand the wind. You have to know that Jesus is with you through it. That is the piece that the disciples missed, that Jesus is in complete control over all of my situations. And if he could handle feeding thousands and thousands of people on the kid's lunch, he can take care of this. This wind is not a big deal to Jesus Christ. It is nothing to him. He is treading on the waves surrounding your life. Whatever trial you are going through, the wind feels a lot to me at times. It's nothing to the Lord. He's in total control, and he has compassion on you to bring you through. So when you're making painful headway, when the trial is going and going and going, remember Jesus's compassion and his power have come through in the past in your life, and they'll come through in the future. And because they missed all of this, it says their hearts were hardened. This is the idea of a callus that would form, like on the hands of a kid on the monkey bars. He continues to do that and he builds up a callus. Or on the fingertips of someone who plays the guitar for hours and hours and hours. Or the callus that would develop on the feet of a child who would run around barefoot all day long. And many of those calluses are good, but here we see that callus is on their heart. If you have a callous heart, you have allowed yourself to become insensitive to how God is working. And that's what the disciples do here. They're insensitive to seeing God's working. Here's a couple steps. How to have a callous heart. How to have a callous heart. First, ignore instructions from God's word. Ignore instructions from God's word. I'm going to hear what God's word has to say, but I'm not going to do it. I'm going to know it, but I'm not going to act on it. I'm not going to put it into practice. Secondly, ignore the prompting of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to sense the Lord leading me to do something for him, but I'm not going to do that. That time when you feel like, man, I should talk to my coworker about Jesus, and now would be a perfect spot, and you just feel that in the Spirit leading you, like, I got to go do that, and then you make an excuse, and you don't do those kinds of things over and over and over. You're building up a callous in your heart. Third, ignore fellow believers' advice. You know, I know my small group says that I should do this, but I got it on my own. I'm going to kind of go my own way on this. I'm going to live in isolation through this trial. I'm going to listen to my heart through it all. It's a terrible idea. I'm going to listen to my heart through it all, even though the people around me who love me and love the Lord and know God's word tell me otherwise. I'm going to do what I want to do. It's going to be fine. You're building up a callous on your heart. And then lastly, what the disciples have done, forget what God has done in the past. When you lose sight of what God has accomplished in your life for his glory and for your good, you are building up a callous. When you fail to remember and to celebrate and to give thanks for the good in your life that God has blessed you with, you are building up a callous. Do these things, and a callous will form, and your heart will be hard before the Lord. And that's what the disciples had done. They'd lost sight of what he had done in their hearts. They'd lost sight of what he had done in their lives and all around them over and over and over, and their hearts were hardened through it. Make no mistake, you make the choice of a hardened heart. You choose it again and again and again and again by doing these things. But Hebrews says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. If you are hearing the Lord's voice, you have the opportunity for a tender heart before the Lord. So remain tender. Come back to these things. Hear God's word and act on it. Listen to God's Spirit. Submit yourselves to other believers and remember what God has done in your life, and your heart can remain tender before the Lord. In the midst of all of this confusion, we can have clarity that Jesus' authority will accomplish his purpose. And lastly, Jesus would say, I am hope for your healing. You notice here this additional section in 53, when they crossed over, they came to the land at Gennesaret, moored to the shore. And when they had got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countryside, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and implored him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment, and as many as touched it were made well. Now again, originally they were headed toward Bethsaida, which is kind of on the north side. They end up at Gennesaret, which is on the west side of the lake. Now, likely because of the heavy wind, perhaps because now that Jesus is in the boat, let's go somewhere else. But whatever the case, they end up at a different place that they had set off for, around the Sea of Galilee. And as soon as they arrive, people start flocking to them again to be healed by Jesus. So likely, this is in the morning. Now, none of them had slept. They've been up all night fighting this storm. Jesus has been up all night praying after a long day of ministry. And as soon as they arrive, here's the hurting people again. Just flocks and flocks of people. Yet here again, Jesus' compassion and his power come together. And he heals many people. Verse 56 is really a summary statement of Jesus' ministry throughout the book of Mark. What Mark is telling us here is that what happened in this situation with all of these people flocking to Jesus and him healing them, that this wasn't just something that happened once. It's like, it wasn't just this time. Whenever he went out and wherever he was, people brought people from everywhere who were sick, and he healed all of them. You see that they're imploring him. They're calling out to him, this strong request, falling at his feet and begging them. And he's healing them by just touching a string from his shirt. This is astonishing power from Jesus. We've seen already in Mark that these healings of Jesus weren't just rare, but they were an ongoing thing. But just think how incredible it would have been to be healed by just the string off of Jesus's shirt. I don't know how this flu season has been for your household. It hadn't been great for ours. Man, it'd be great if we had a Jesus fringe around here, you know? It'd be incredible. Amen. I got a couple amens there. The truth is that God still does miraculous healings. God still heals this way. Now, we don't see that God heals on demand in the way that he did with Jesus and with the apostles as the church was begun, but God still heals miraculously. I think it's helpful, though, to mention very briefly three common errors in our thinking about God's miraculous healing and how healing works. First is this idea of all sovereignty. God will just, he'll do his will. He's sovereign over it all. I don't need to pray. God knows what I need. He's sovereign. I don't need to pray about it. I'm not going to ask him. But look, the people here are imploring. They're falling at his feet and begging him to heal him. Some people are in the all faith camp. If you don't get healed, you didn't have enough faith. That's your problem. I mean, Jesus is willing. It's still available, so you must not have faith. But the interesting thing is we don't see anything about the faith of the people who got healed here. We see the urgency of the people bringing them and falling before them and calling out to them. But we don't actually hear anything about if the people even had faith. But they're there. These are also the people who don't ever go to the doctor, but they just think that if I just have enough faith, then I'll be healed. And then the third camp will be the people who never ask. You know, God doesn't even do that anymore. Just forget it. I'm going to the doctor. I'm not going to pray about it. I'm not going to ask for prayer about it. I don't need to ask God to heal. There's also the essential oil people who think, you know, if you have a broken leg, wrap some lavender on it and you're fine. But that's a whole other camp, and that's for another time. But the truth is God does miraculously heal. He tells us in James 5:14 that is any among you sick or hurting, you should call to the elders of the church and they will anoint you with oil and pray over you. This is something that we still do as a church because we believe God's word. We believe that that passage is true. And we have seen God miraculously heal people before. We believe that he will do it again. But God gave us wisdom. He gave us medicine. He gave us doctors. So we should go to the doctor as well. We should pray to the Lord as well. And however the Lord chooses to heal us, I'm going to give him praise for that. I'm going to give him glory for that because he's healed. And I'm going to trust him that even if he chooses not to heal me, I'm going to trust that what he has in store for me is far better than my finite mind can comprehend because he's working his good in me. But here Jesus is willing. He's compassionate. He's not frustrated. He's not like, listen, guys, I've been up all night. It was a long day yesterday. I got time for like six of you, okay? And then after that, we got to call it a day. I need a nap. He doesn't do any of that. It says he healed as many as were there. As many as came to him were made well. When you're hurting, Jesus gives you power and compassion. If he didn't have compassion, he wouldn't heal you. He'd have the ability, but he'd go off and take a nap. And if he didn't have power, he might want to heal you, but not be able to. And he'd just pat you on the head and offer you a cold compress and be like, sorry, hope you get better, buddy. But here, the incredible power and compassion of Jesus come together as he stands and says, it is I, it's me. I'm hope over your healing. There's power in the presence of a Savior who has all authority. He has all authority over my storm. He has all authority over my confusion. He has all authority over my need for healing. And we're going to end today where Jesus began, in prayer, going to the Lord, calling out in this way. We're going to open up the front of the church if you'd like to come forward. I won't make you say anything. I'm going to pray over you in a minute. But maybe you're here today and you're going through a storm. It's not the severity of the storm necessarily, but it's the length of it. It's not the strength of the storm, it's the length of the storm. And I don't know if I can go another day. I don't know when the end is coming, this trial that's in my life. I'm laying it before His presence. And I want to receive in a new way the power that comes from His presence in my life. If that's you, in a moment, I want you to come forward. Maybe today you, like the disciples, are feeling lost and confused. Maybe it's because of choices that you have made that have hardened your heart. Or maybe you've never opened your heart to receive Jesus Christ by faith. That if you would turn from your sins, as these two students did today, if you've turned from your sins and embraced Jesus Christ by faith, He alone can save you. He alone can provide for you. He alone can bring you through the storms of life, and He alone is with you through it all. And apart from Him, we can do nothing. So maybe you've never turned to Jesus before, and today could be that day. You're getting up from your seat in a moment and coming forward to pray is a symbol to say, Lord, I receive You. I turn from my sins and trust Jesus Christ by faith. And maybe that you just desire a softer heart before the Lord. Your reactions to the circumstances in your life haven't shown that you're fully trusting, fully surrendering, fully experiencing His presence in your life. The clarity that you can receive today is that Jesus' presence brings power in your life. And maybe like in this last section, you're in need of healing. You're in need of physical healing. I've just been to the doctor so many times and I don't know what else to do. I'm at the end of my rope. God can heal you. He can heal you through those doctors. He can heal you miraculously this morning. We believe all of it, that God can work. And we're going to pray for your healing today. Some of you maybe need emotional healing. Well, you can't see the scars on the outside, but trust me, they're there. That the pain that I'm feeling is just as real if I needed an MRI to see it. And you're experiencing that pain and in need of deep physical healing or deep spiritual or deep emotional healing that only Jesus can do. So we're going to sing this song and we're going to trust the Lord. We're going to come before Him in prayer. And so if that's you, if you're desirous of any of these things, I want you to come forward as we sing, and I'm going to pray over us in a moment before we conclude our service. Let's sing together.